Having finished the row decoder discussion, we'll now move on to the last two parts of our peripheral design, which are the column multiplexers and the precharge and sense amplifiers, which I'm not going to go into deep detail, but they also can be researched heavily. So let's start with the column multiplexer. So we have here the column multiplexer, which is the part that takes the bit lines and actually drives them out to the data out. Remember, we're going to be folding several of these words onto one row, and we need to usually output only one row. So let's say we have 32 bits and we only want to output 8 bits, so we have to have 8 multiplexer instances that will choose one of these 8-bit sets of the four bytes that are on that same row to drive out to the output. Okay, so how are we going to do that? Well, the easiest way actually is to use a decoder. So you can see here we have a two-input decoder. It gets A0 and A1. It chooses one of these one-hot outputs. So it's a 2-to-4 decoder in this case. And the one-hot output is connected to one of the bit lines. So you see that only one of these will be enabled at a certain time, and it will drive bit line 0, bit line 1, bit line 2, or bit line 3 to the output. And that's really easy. It's fast. There's only one signal in the one transistor in the signal path. So once we enable one of the bit lines, really the data can go directly to the output, and that's a real nice thing. You can see here a type of a transistor level implementation of it. So we have this part here is the 2-to-4 decoder, and we just saw real heavily how to design a row decoder, and this decoder is the same. It's just going to be in the size of M is the multiplexing factor. So this is M, and this is 2 to the power of M, right? So that's the number of decoders, and there again are going to be 2 to the power of M bits on each, words on each row. Okay, and we're going to choose one of the 2 to the power of M words and drive it to the output. That is what the column multiplexer is doing. So we often call this a Y decoder or a column decoder because we make the multiplexer here using a decoder, as you can see. So the other option is to use what we call a tree decoder. And so here's a simple tree decoder. Again, we're going to have an M equals 2 in the example. So that means we have 4 columns. Okay, 2 to the power of M, and we want to take 4 columns and only propagate one of them to the output. Okay, so what we do here is we need the multiplexing factor number of transistors in series. So each one of these bit lines is connected to a transistor that is that gets the A0 or A0 bar input, and then these two together are separated by either one of the A1 bar or A1 bit, okay, because both of them will, you know, they both get A1 bar. So A1 bar connects this set to the output, and then we differentiate between this set by the A0 bar or A1 bar, but then the signal has to propagate through two transistors. And of course, if we make the multiplexing factor higher, then this propagation becomes a quadratic increase because of the resistance that we put on the line. Okay, now we have to remember that everything I'm showing here on the right is just one bit line. We actually have a pair of bit lines, so it comes out a bunch of transistors, but this is for sure less than what would have been when we made the decoder, the column decoder in the previous slide. So since we have no external decoding logic, we get a large area reduction, and this is one way to do it. Just another point here, in both cases, if we want a full swing, then we won't be using just an NMOS transistor. We'll be using a CMOS pass gate, so we'll have an NMOS and PMOS transistor for each one of these blocks. But these are decisions that we have to make according to our sense amplifiers and so forth that we are going to make. Now, again, both of these tree decoder and the tree decoder and the standard row type of decoder with select, they have their pros and cons, so we may as well combine the two. So in this case, we can see we took a 4-bit address, so we have 16 of these that we need to multiplex, and we can use, for example, at a first stage, we can have the select through the fast and low resistance type of decoding scheme, and then we can put it into a tree decoder. So when we design our column decoder or our column multiplexer, we should really go and look and try to find the best combination that we can find, and these things have their pros and cons. There are other ways to continue implementing this, but this is the basic idea. So that was just all I had to say really about a column multiplexer at this stage. And so let's go into the last part, which is our precharge and sense amplifiers. And this is going to be what's called in this figure over here, bitline conditioning, how we're going to actually treat the bitlines. So first, we're going to start with the precharging before reads. So you saw that before a read, we have to take bitline and bitline bar and bring them up to VDD. And that's actually pretty easy to do. So we just put a PMOS in series with the bitline and with the bitline bar. And we connect the gate of the PMOS to some sort of a phase of the clock, or it could be a self-time clock or something that turns them on, precharges the lines, and then turns it off. Okay. Usually what we're going to actually want to do is add an additional transistor, which we call an equalizer transistor, that's going to be connected between the bitline and bitline bar, just to make the variation a bit smaller. So it's going to be pretty important how we precharge these things, because we're going to be using a differential sense amplifier, as we'll see in a minute. So usually this extra transistor is something that's going to be used and really cause the same initial voltage to be on both of these bitlines. What's a sense amplifier? And that's here at the bottom of the thing. And it can come before the decoder or after the decoder. Nowadays, usually you have a sense amplifier at the bottom of each row, not after moving it out through a decoder, which adds additional noise and so forth. So basically, if we want to see what the speed through our for our read is, the speed is going to be, something like the capacitance, and we want to have as many bits as possible on our bit lines. In other words, we want to have as many rows as possible. So the capacitance is going to be large. Okay, the average current that we're going to be dissipating, that's going to be small, because we have one transistor over here that's going to be discharging that long, word line, and it's going to be as close to minimum size transistor as possible, because again, this is inside some sort of an SRAM cell, so we really want it to be small. And so what can we do to reduce the delay? We can make delta V, the swing that we're going to want to actually discharge, as small as possible. So that's the point of the sense amplifier, is to go and be able to see and recognize a small change and take it and amplify it into a large change. Okay. Remember, again, with timing diagrams, if we look at the timing diagrams, we're going to have one side that's the side that's storing a 1. This is T, and this is the V. So let's say that on the bit line, on that side, we're storing a 1, then VBL is going to stay at VDD. That's VBL. On the other hand, if right here we start the read, okay, at this point, so what's going to happen is that VBLB is going to start going down. And what we say is that if we can recognize this difference rather than this difference, then the TPD, the T axis, will be smaller in this case. So that's what the sense amplifier is trying to do. Take as small as possible a change here and recognize and turn it into a 1 or a 0. So how do we do that? We use a sense amplifier. It's just a comparator, basically, and it's going to try to turn this small transition into a nice large digital output. How do we make a sense amplifier? Well, going back to an analog circuits type of a course, we will use usually a differential sense amplifier. So it's just basically a differential pair. Okay. And as you can see here, what we're going to do is, when we're ready to sense, we turn on these PMOSes, we connect bitline and bitline bar to the sides here of the NMOSes, and at some point, because of the difference between the two sides, we're going to have really one of the sides shoot up and one of the sides shoot down. What we usually do is not this, because it wastes a lot of power. In other words, this SRAM is going to be sitting there. All these sense amplifiers are going to be dissipating power all the time. So we're usually going to have this synchronized with a clock. So we're going to have some sort of a sensing clock that's going to turn off the sense amplifier, so we don't waste power during standby, or during times when we're not reading, and only turn it on really when we need to read the output. So this sense clock over here, it's going to actually be connected in two places. First of all, it's going to be connected to the sync transistor over here, and turn it off so we're not dissipating any power when we're not sensing. That's number one. And the other thing, which is quite important, is that we're going to isolate the bit lines from the rest of it when we start sensing. So if in our previous slide we saw that there's this time that over here we know that we're going to be able to at this point sense the difference, what we do here is at this point we're going to have this sense clock go up. It's going to turn this and this transistor off and isolate the whole long bit line with its large capacitance over here and the bit line bar with its large capacitance over here. These have gone down to VDD minus delta V, and this one's at VDD, let's say. Okay, but at this point we turn this off, we isolate just this part with which has a small capacitance, you know, and this part that has a small capacitance, and then we can drive this one all the way down to zero. So the waste of power is small. It also takes a lot less time for these cross-coupled inverters that are inside to drive that down. As you can see, this is a different design, a bit different design than here. We have this cross-coupled inverter pair, which is basically like a 6T SRAM cell that then drives the heavy feedback. So basically, we start over here, and if we're a bit over to here, it's going to pull down to this side. If we're a bit over here, it's going to pull down to this side. That's a kind of a cross-coupled inverter pair type of a differential sense amplifier. So we can either do it with the current mirror type or with the with the cross-coupled inverter type. Sense amplifiers can be a whole long discussion. I'm not going to go into it. It's a lot of type of stuff that can be done. Really, that's one of the most important part is try to get a low noise sense amplifier that has a good ability to sense the output. That leads us to our computer hall of fame. And for this lesson, we're going to show the DEC VAX. This is Digital Equipment Corporation. And their VAX machine was a very important machine that a lot of people have run into because they're still used actually in certain places. And at least when I was younger, they were commonly used. So this was a 32-bit CISC architecture, a complex instruction set computer. It was introduced in 1977. The VAX 11780 was based on TTL, which are BJT transistors. It's not a CMOS type of thing. It worked at the whopping 5 megahertz, had 2 kilobytes of cache, and it reached 1 million instructions per second, which was a big number back then. It was a mini computer, so as you can see, you could probably put it in your pocket. It was very mini. No, it actually took up a whole room. VAX actually stands for Virtual Address Extension, since VAX was one of the first mini computers to use virtual memory. The operating system that ran on VAX was called VMS, and that's a very very famous operating system from the past. And a lot of the systems that were developed during the Cold War, such as the F-15, F-18, Hawk missiles, and nuclear programs, they still use the VAX today, and that's why I chose to put it into the Computer Hall of Fame and show it to all of you. So that was the end of our lecture about memory peripherals, and I hope you know how to basically design a memory now. So just for further reading, of course, you can go to the Digital Integrated Circuits wonderful textbook or to Elad Alon's lectures that these were mostly based on.